energy, the faith, the devotion.
Imagine a place that you can believe in. Not just another fantasy land that your grandparents tell you about. A place where a new hero is born each day. A place where everyone is invited and everyone gets to play. A place where no matter what your age, you don't have to grow up. Well, many might say, oh, a place like this doesn't exist. Shh, it does. Look closely, and you will see the excitement of the Little League World Series. In their land, where baseball reigns supreme, California remains undefeated after silencing the bats of powerful Texas. And tonight, they hope to expand on the Golden State's impressive legacy. Born with gloves on their hands and a confident stride, Curaçao's heart never stops beating for baseball. These freewheeling spirits carry a country's hope in their first championship appearance ever. For 365 days a year, every kid here daydreams about reaching this moment. Tonight, for two teams, the dream finally comes true. California versus Curaçao in the Little League World Series Championship. Coming up next. Representing the United States here tonight, the unbeaten youngsters from Thousand Oaks, California. And on the international side, a group of very talented little leaguers from Willemstad, Curaçao, the Netherlands Antilles, as we get ready here on ABC for the Little League World Series championship game. Both Thousand Oaks and Curaçao 5-0 since coming to South Williamsport. You know, back in June, 7,000 teams started this battle, and we're down to the final two. Both California and the Netherlands Antilles got here with 4-0 shutouts in their respective championships the other evening. Well, welcome, everybody. I'm Brett Musburger. We don't have to tell you how powerful this California team is, unbeaten in South Williamsport, but for the summer, they're 22-0. They've trailed only three innings all summer long. But their opponents from Curaçao are no baseball fluke. Curaçao is a tiny island, which is located off the coast of Venezuela. They are baseball crazy. And because they're part of the Netherlands Antilles, their athletes are eligible to compete for Holland in the Olympics. And at the just completed Olympic Games in Athens, Greece, 7 graduates of the Little League program in Curaçao played for Holland. It won't be long before Andrew Jones and Randall Simon Herald are joined by some of their countrymen in the major leagues. As speaking to the big leagues, we welcome in the Pied Piper of baseball, Mr. Reynolds. And Harold, it's been a long time since we've seen a Little League team any better rounded than this California group.
You're absolutely right. I mean, they pitch, they play defense, they hit the ball. Let's go back to the championship game last night, though. Cody Thompson, 12 strikeouts. He only gave up one hit. His pitches were 70 miles an hour, which is equivalent to 90 miles an hour for the Major League mound. 46 feet in Little League, remember that. That's why he was dominating these hitters last night, and he put them into this game with a tremendous pitching performance. But Brett, you're absolutely right. It's been the defense that's really carried them. They've had 106 chances here at the Little League World Series, and they've only committed 2 errors. And that double play right there, just an example of the type of defense they play.
Hey, here's one of their sluggers, catcher John Lister, and look who's helping us out there with a little camera work. That's the starting pitcher tonight, folks, and it shows you this team is really relaxed. Now, speaking of being relaxed, let's turn our attention to Curaçao. They have been a delight here in South Williamsport.
Well, they've been fun, and they got 2 youngsters that lead this club, Carlos Pineda and Jonathan Scope. You see them there? They're fighting for the spotlight like they've been doing the whole week long. Who's the best? Well, we'll see. But on the mound so far, this young man has been offensively 7-for-10. You see the power with the follow-through. No doubt about it, he's hit 3 home runs. But on the mound, now remember, he's coming off a 137-pitch outing on Wednesday in the semifinal game to get them here. And he has been the big force, but Jonathan Scope, the shortstop. He's got a brother who plays in the Giant organization, and you can see this young man's range. He was here last year, and he's back again, so he's got the experience.
There's Pineda Harold out warming up and getting ready for his start against California here tonight. And as for Jordan Brower, folks, his outpitch, a knuckleball. We'll see how that works out. Now, we talked about Curaçao being the most relaxed team here at the Little League World Series. I don't think any team has ever had more fun the last 4 years than these youngsters from Curaçao. What a delight.
Series World Championship on ABC Sports, brought to you by Berry Burst Cheerios and State Farm. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
The parade of nations here earlier tonight, 16 teams, 8 from the United States and 8 international teams, and now we've come down to Thousand Oaks, California and Curaçao for the World Championship. And our youngest reporter, a pleasure to have him with us again this year. Let's go down now to Grant Paulson. Grant.
Thanks again, Brent. I'm here with tonight's starter for Thousand Oaks. Jordan Brower is with me now. One of the pitches in your repertoire is a knuckleball. You actually got to talk to a Major League Baseball great, Tom Candiotti. What did he tell you about the knuckleball?
Well, first of all, I taught him how to throw my knuckleball, which is with my knuckles down. But then he taught me how to throw his, digging his nails into it. Then I tried his out, and it worked a lot better. So tonight, I'm going to dig it in with my knuckles.
So you started the show showing him, and then he kind of gave you some tips. But you also celebrated your 13th birthday here in Williamsport after you left the house. How did you celebrate the birthday?
We went to a pizza place in the mall, and presents I got was mostly money. And it's great to celebrate my 13th birthday here in Williamsport playing in the Little League World Series.
Absolutely. He's hoping for one more late birthday gift, Brent.
Nice job, Grant. It's tremendous. He taught me his, and it was better. So I'm going to pitch for that. The coin toss won by the Caribbean champions. So Curaçao will be pouring out onto the field now. And our lineups here for this championship game are presented by State Farm. There's the batting order for Thousand Oaks, California. And let's have the youngsters introduce themselves to you.
My name is Tammy Ginther, and my favorite player is Ken Griffey Jr., and I like to play Wiffle Ball.
My name is Dan Leon, and my favorite player is Sammy Sosa. I like to play ping pong.
My name is Sean McIntyre. My favorite baseball player is Darren Erstad. My hobbies are playing ping pong.
My name is Jordan Brower, and my favorite player is Chipper Jones. I also like to play basketball and football.
My name is Tyler Karp, and my favorite player is Eric Gagne, and I can't wait to meet him.
Hi, my name is John Lister, and my favorite player is Mike Lieberthal because he's a catcher just like me.
My name is Cody Thompson, and my favorite player is Albert Pujols, and my favorite band is Van Halen.
My name is James Brady, my favorite player is Derek Jeter, and one of my hobbies is playing ping pong.
Hi, my name is Hayden Cronenbull, and my favorite player is Alex Rodriguez. I also like to play soccer.
Hi, I'm Adam Dociano, and my favorite player is Nomar Garcia-Parra.
My name is Derek Francis, and my favorite player is Sammy Sosa.
Hi, my name's Evan Ocello, and my favorite player is Barry Bonds.
All right, let's meet the kids from Curaçao. In left field, we've got Riondell Walter. He likes cartoons, and his favorite team is the Atlanta Braves. The center fielder, Courtney Doron. He likes to eat chicken, and he also plays soccer. Pretty good soccer player. The right fielder, Gerson Adams. He likes McDonald's. Just give me anything from McDonald's, and his favorite athlete is the soccer star Ronaldo. The third baseman, Jerkson Profar, he said for good luck, he doesn't wash his uniform. Don't get close to him. He wants to meet the wizard, Ozzie Smith. The shortstop, Jonathan Scope, his favorite subject in school is drama, and his favorite actor is Will Smith. The second baseman, Sorek Liberia, he would like to meet Alex Rodriguez, and his favorite singer is Usher. The first baseman, Dimitri Hania, he says he likes the Detroit Pistons. Well, they won it all. Front runner, of course. And he said Arnold Schwarzenegger is his favorite actor. The catcher, Reggie Ronde. He likes the Red Sox. And his favorite actor is Eddie Murphy. And on the mound, the big fella, he's 5'11", 170 pounds, Carlos Pineda. He loves Allen Iverson. And he said his favorite sports moment was coming here to Williamsport. And I think he's having a pretty good time. Here's his pitch grip. It's a four-seam fastball. Curveball, he holds off the seam there, and that's it. He's coming after you.
The fans are here, many of them cost them about $1,000 apiece just to make that journey. And of course, on the third base side, many of the fans have traveled here from Thousand Oaks, California, about 30 miles outside of Los Angeles. Good luck charms abound here in both dugouts. And Timmy Genter, son of the manager, steps in, and Pineda's first pitch is high for a ball. The plate umpire here tonight is from Knoxville, Tennessee. Remember now, all these umpires are volunteers, so we'll have Phil Morton calling balls and strikes here. Timmy gets ready, bluffs a bunt, and he'll be taking a strike now. The umpires also are from Florida, Inglewood, Florida, Millsboro, Delaware, Ohio. Got the Netherlands represented out in left field by Bobby Gums in Aurora, Colorado. So a variety of locations, hometowns for these umpires, and it's 3-0, and Timmy will be taking all the way.
He might take a couple. The big fella's a little pumped up right now, throwing pretty hard. We'll see what the velocity is. See what 3-0 count and the 0 is. A drop of bug there. That'll tell us how hard that was. It was right at him. 70 miles an hour and 91, equivalent to Major League Baseball. We got our first base runner, Brent.
Thousand Oaks 5-0. Battled against Rhode Island in their opener. Then got past Morganton, North Carolina, Davenport, Iowa. Had a tough semifinal matchup. Didn't expect it to be against Preston, and then they were just awesome in the U.S. Finals against Richmond, Texas, a team that had scored 51 runs in four games. And Pineda can't find the plate here early, and this is a Little League bugaboo.
Yeah, he's a little excited right now. We see that oftentimes in this big of a ball game. First inning, pitchers struggle a little bit with their control, and just a little bit anxious.
Danny Leon, the hitter, takes the first call strike, and you will note, and Harold has certainly observed it several times during this competition, that the umpires here will frequently widen out the strike zone just a little bit so that we don't have games that are one walk after another. Huh? And there's a good look at Phil Morton. Mass cam will show you that shot. Good view from what the umpire sees behind there. And it's two balls and a strike. If you're wondering about the A-H-O there for Curacao, well, that's the Antilles. And H-O, of course, the old symbol for Holland. Back in the Olympic days. So that's the Netherlands Antilles, if you will, and that's the logo they use in Olympic competition.
And we had cameras everywhere. We even got them on the umpire. Here's what we call hat cam. This is the second base umpire, and this is the view you're going to see from him. And that comes in real handy. And then right here, obviously, we're looking right in on the home plate ump. This is mass cam. This is what the home plate umpire sees coming at him. See Dan Leon foul one back.
Danny Leon, Harold, one of the better-looking athletes at this year's Little League World Series. He's got a ton of speed, good basketball player, we were told by his manager. He started that slick double play that Harold showed you in our lead into this game. Made a fine play on his knees and threw a perfect strike to second base. Mound cam now shows you Pineda hit in the air into right field and playable. So Adames makes the first put out of the game, and we can take a look at the dimensions here.
Well, Little League obviously is going to be a lot smaller than Major League Baseball. And here's what a Major League park on the average would look like, but the key is 60 feet 6 inches from the mound, 90 feet on the base paths. That doesn't change. And Little League is 46 feet, 60 feet on the bases, and the fences are 205 all the way around. So that's how we get that nice Little League ballpark. Kids are 11 and 12 years old, and some 13-year-olds, August 1st, they have to be before then. They cannot be 13 before that date.
Sean McIntyre, he pitched a couple of games ago. The other thing about this California team that you should be aware of, it has the deepest pitching staff of any of the teams here at the Little League World Series. They can go about five deep and still present good arms. That pitch is high. McIntyre's left-handed all the way, and here is the stopper from last night. I mean, Cody Thompson was overpowering. A dozen strikeouts, a bloop single to right field. And remember, the right fielder slipped a little bit, and we might have had a no-hitter last night as McIntyre swings through the pitch by Pineda.
It's interesting early, Brent. You know, Cody Thompson was throwing about the same speed as Pineda is right now last night, and they never made the adjustment. It looks like California's already made a pretty good adjustment to this power. I didn't think they'd be able to do that.
The target set up outside by Ronde. How about the comparison of pitch speeds, Harold?
As you see on the left is Little League, and on the right is Major League Fastball. The higher number is obviously Major League Fastball. Remember, Little League is 46 feet, so you're looking at a reaction time. He just threw a pitch 73, which is equivalent to 95 in the big leagues. Again, that's a 95-mile-an-hour fastball if you're watching a Major League Baseball game. That's get it up there.
Did Pineda throw 135 pitches in an earlier game? Is that what you told me
today? His last outing.
Yeah, because they're making him work here in the first inning.
And that's going to come into play. It's a great point, Brent. Excellent point.
2-2 with one out. Pineda looks in now to Vonday. And the count is full with Timmy Ginther on at first base. Jordan Brower, the starting pitcher, is next here for California. We are in the top of the first. This is the Little League World Championship game between the United States, represented by Thousand Oaks, California, and the international side by Curaçao, the Netherlands Antilles. Took the strike called that time, and it's two out with Brower coming up.
Looked like he took a little something off that fastball right there.
Well, Thousand Oaks, we mentioned, was close to Los Angeles, and the population, a little over 100,000, and a region known for golf and wine. In other words, mighty good place to live, folks. And, they got themselves a fine Little League program. Very nice people from that area. Tom Ginther, the manager, has done a great job with these youngsters. And Brower, the starting pitcher here tonight, takes one up high. I am so impressed through the years coming in here and listening to the maturity of, I know some people say, hey, you're television guys, you put a lot of pressure on it. Folks, they don't even know we're around. I mean, they just go on about their business and they talk like big leaguers when you hold a microphone up to them. They are very aware.
Well, that's the generation that we're in now, too. These kids are so advanced with all the technology they have. They're right on top. But here's a good look at a high fastball in the strike zone. So the zone's going to be big. It's up high and also wide. So the umpire widens it up, and as a result, we'll get a little bit quicker game than we normally would.
Up a little bit too high. Over in the dugout, Jordan's father, Rick Brower, one of the coaches. And mom is here with the fans watching upstairs. And these parents volunteer and give so much of their time when you consider you start way back in June with All-Star competition. Got the low strike that time, and Pineda says thank you very much.
Yeah, they're going to have to make an adjustment to the low and high. So he's getting outside, up, low, and down. So it's going to be interesting to see. There's three father-son combinations on this team from California. So that's pretty unique in itself. You've got the Leons, the George Brower's dad, you just saw that, and then Danny Leon, his dad, is on the club also as a coach, so that's pretty unusual.
So again, we go to the full count, two out. California runner on at first base. Missing outside. Two walks.
Well, Brent, you hit it on the nose when you said he threw 135 pitches in Wednesday's game that he pitched in. The first thing you see is as these youngsters might be a little nervous for one right now, but it is fatigue, because the first thing all of a sudden location goes away when they get tired.
You know, I want to correct myself. Even though that would have been ball four, Ginther was hit by a pitch on that would have been ball four. So we have one walk and one hit batsman, as it is fouled away here by Tyler Karp, the fine-looking shortstop. So 24 pitches already, and 11 of them strikes in the first inning by young Pineda.
I was wondering what they would call that, ball four or hit by.
Yeah, I wondered at the time.
Yeah.
No balls and a strike.
Ball.
I guess a badge of honor, you want to say you got hit.
Absolutely. In Ginther's case, he just wants to get on. Two on, two out here for California in the top of the first inning of the Little League Championship game. Strikers taken. Here is, in case you just snapped on set, here's the pitch we were talking about. Just grazing there in the pants. And so what would have easily been also ball four was the hit batsman. And strike three. So even though he hit a batter and walked one, he also strikes out two. And California scoreless in the top of the first. Welcome back to the Little League World Series, and for more on that beautiful island of Curaçao, let's go down below now to Sam Ryan. Sam.
And
Brent, you mentioned it was off the coast of Venezuela, 44 miles off the South American coast. And you can look across on a clear day and see Venezuela. The national language, official language, is Dutch, but the language that you're hearing them speak, the language that all the kids speak, is Papamiento. That's a combination of Portuguese, Spanish, Dutch, French, a little bit of English in there, and Latin. Just a beautiful language to listen to. Now, only five major leaguers, past and present, hail from the island of Curaçao. The most popular, you mentioned him earlier, Andrew Jones, the first. This guy Harold remembers, Hensley Bam Bam Mullins, back in 1989, guys.
All right, Samantha. Papamiento, huh? Hang down there and learn a few words, because I'm not sure Harold and I can handle that as we meet this Curaçao lineup now, presented by State Farm. And what a fine group of youngsters. Let's have them now introduce themselves to you.
My name is Ryan DeWalt, and my favorite baseball player is Andrew Jones. I like basketball.
Hi, my name is Gerson Adamas. My favorite baseball player is J.D. Drew. I like swimming.
Hi, my name is Jonathan Scope. My favorite baseball player is Derek Jeter. I like video games.
My name is Carlos Pineda, and my favorite baseball player is Barry Bonds. I like French fries.
My name is Jurek Sampropa. My favorite baseball player is Alex Rodriguez. I like movies.
My name is Dimitri Kinnan. My favorite baseball player is Albert Pujols. I like chicken.
Hi, my name is Kenny Durant. My favorite baseball player is Andrew Drew. I like swimming.
Hi, my name is Sarek Liberia, and my favorite baseball player is Alex Rodriguez. I like PlayStation.
Hi, my name is Reginald Rondé. My favorite baseball player is Manny Ramirez, and I like video games.
Hi, my name is Christopher Garriga. My favorite baseball player is Sammy Sosa.
Hi, my name is Charlton Miles. My favorite baseball player is Manny Ramirez.
Hi, my name is Willie Rafaela. My favorite baseball player is Sammy Sosa.
Hi, my name is Quincy Van Larkham. My favorite baseball player is J.T. Drew.
My name is Dirty Knush. My favorite baseball player is Derek Jeter.
All right, let's meet the youngsters from California representing the West. In left field, we got Sean McIntyre. His favorite book is To Kill a Mockingbird, and he loves to eat ribs. The center fielder, Timmy Ginther, he has his own batting cage at his house. He loves Adam Sandler, and his favorite band is Newfound Glory. The right fielder, Cody Thompson, he pitched that spectacular game yesterday. He likes the Chicago Cubs, and his hobby is riding his scooter. The third baseman, Hayden Cronenbold, he likes the book Dr. Doolittle, and his favorite subject is math. The shortstop, Tyler Karp, his favorite movie is The Sandlot. I love that movie. His role model is his father. The second baseman, James Brady, his favorite food is spaghetti, and his superstition, he doesn't step on the foul line. That's why he's playing second. The first baseman, Danny Leon, he grew 8 inches this year. That's why he is such a big kid at this age. His favorite food is chicken pizza. The catcher, John Lister, his favorite subject is social studies, and his favorite football team is the New England Patriots. Brent, he's a linebacker. I know you like that. And the pitcher, Jordan Brower, he likes to eat tacos, and his hobby is playing on the computer. And let's take a look at his pitch grips. Talked about that knuckleball quite a bit. Here's his four-seam fastball. He's not going to run it up there quite as hard as these other pitchers. And he's got a little bit of a curveball. He'll feature his off-speed pitches a lot, and this knuckleball we'll see quite a bit. The new Tom Candiotti knuckleball, of course.
Ball. Of course. First pitch from him is outside. Walter, the leadoff hitter here for Curaçao. Scoreless bottom of the first inning. Little League Baseball, regularly scheduled game, 6 innings.
Ball.
Just missing. Thought he might cut. Caught the front part of that plate.
But, two balls, no strike.
Morton had a better view.
Right, you see the speed on him, 66 miles an hour, considerably slower. He's a pinpoint guy. He'll drop down to the side. He's got to hit the corners. You know, they got it all down, Brent.
Oh. And he's behind in this count now. 3-1 to the leadoff hitter.
Dirksen Profar, this young man right here, he's got a bright future, great hands.
And the count is full. Earlier today, that fine team from Richmond, Texas won the consolation game. They beat Mexico, so they go home third place winners. Lost in the U.S. semifinal to these youngsters from California. Swung on and missed, and it's the first strikeout of the game.
He's got that little drop-down fastball. It's tough to pick up. He comes slinging it across on the right-hander. You can see the angle. Watch how the ball's going to cut across the batter's box, and that's tough to pick up at this age. You got to hit this ball to right field, and he just wasn't able to catch up to it.
Let's see what Adames can do here. He presents a small target as he steps in for Brouwer. So all week long, they look at a variety of fastballs, huh, Harold? And then they come to the championship game, and now we suddenly got somebody who changes speeds. Shows us a little knuckleball, man. What a change that is for these youngsters.
Ball.
And the most difficult thing to learn to hit is the off-speed pitch. That's why it takes so long for guys to get that feel for it. And that's why so many people quit playing at this level. Once they leave Little League, that's it. Couldn't hit the off-speed pitch.
Ball.
Keeping it down. Behind in the count, though, for the second time.
And you talked earlier, Brent, about Lister, how important it's going to be for the catcher to catch the ball, because it's very important in this game, in Little League, in the game, the catcher becomes a vital part of how players advance base to base.
Got that knee-high strike. You saw Lister looking over to the dugout when we had that fine tight shot of him. The pitches are called by Tom Ginther over there in the dugout. There he is. You can see him hiding the pitch. He makes the call there, and then Lister relays it on out to Brouwer. So again, we've gone 3-1. Two strikes to the knees. Count is full.
Is that three?
He called him. He rung him up.
He's got a mic over there. At this point of the competition, you get a little nervous over there. He fouls this one out of play down the right field.
Well, a lot of times you'll see a dramatic call from the umpire, so that's what he's saying. Yeah. Well, it looked like he called him out.
Right, here's the Curacao record here at South Williamsport. Tough game against Guadalupe, and had to come back and beat him a second time. And Adames draws ball four, and now here comes one of the finest athletes in this year's Little League World Series. Jonathan Scope, Harold talked about him. He's a slick fielding shortstop, and he can also do some damage with the bat. One of the most impressive comebacks, if not the single best comeback of the competition, was the Caribbean champs from Curacao rallying to eliminate Chinese Taipei. Taipei back in the competition this year. And that'll send Adames into second base. So one of the dangers, one of the dangers of the knuckleball and the off-speed ball bouncing in the dirt, and we have seen Curacao very dangerous on the bases here.
They're very aggressive, and so is this California team. They both play a very similar style of game. You'll see them try to score and ball in the dirt. Runners will be dodging around, advancing. Now, in Little League Baseball, you cannot advance until the ball passes or reaches the batter. Watch this play right here by John Lister. Squares it up, keeps it in front of him. Very important for him. It's a big game for him back there behind the plate.
To the hole. Base hit. Adames rounds. And Curacao strikes first.
Last night we saw the slick outfield. The outfielder slipping and falling. Sean McIntyre, same thing on that play right there. He slipped and fell. And Brent, the aggressiveness of Curacao. They're coming all the way, but watch him field the ball. He slips right as he's fielding. Now he's got no play at home. That's why you didn't see a play at the plate.
And here comes the big slugger. Pineda hit a towering two-run shot. I mean, he was aiming for that new statue of Casey at the bat out beyond the left field wall. The international final the other night. Want to be careful getting this ball up high, because Casey's looking down on him and says, you feed him one and out he'll come. Well, there he is, a great view of crowd up around 30,000, I'm sure, again tonight. Jam-packed. There's been rain in the area, but none here. Little League luck here tonight. Come on, a miss by Pineda.
One ball, one strike.
Yeah. breaking ball.
And that's the one pitch, that's why so many kids at this age are starting to throw breaking balls. I don't necessarily say it's a good thing to do. Your arm is still developing. You have a lot of problems. I wouldn't recommend curveballs until you're about 15, but they all throw them.
Got the big man. That's his second strike out of the inning. And here comes Yurickson Profar, who pitched brilliantly, a one-hitter in beating Mexico in the international championship game the other night. He'll be the fifth hitter, so again, Jordan Brau has to be careful with him. Among the teams that Curaçao eliminated down the Caribbean Championship, the Dominican Republic, and of course all of us here so identify baseball with the Dominican because all the players have reached the major leagues, but Curaçao now has been competing with them and beating them the last 4 years, and on that one they got away from Lister. Taking second base is Jonathan Schoop.
Well, what a nice backup by the second baseman James Brady right there as he dove and knocked that ball down, because Schoop was on his way to third base. You'll see here Lister comes up with the throw, and it gets by the shortstop, Karp. And look at Brady, the great effort, and you can see Schoop getting ready to go to third base. Tremendous. This is what the umpire sees out of hat cam, and that kept them from advancing that runner to third base. Nice play. Heads up.
One ball, one strike. Go.
Runner at second is Schoop. Profar's our hitter. In the air, deep center field. Gone. Profar puts Curaçao up by 3 runs on the home run over the center field wall. How about that?
Well, the first pitch of the at-bat was a curveball. He had a nice swing on it. He fouled it straight back. Again, this is another breaking ball that got up in the eyes, and it didn't break. He about broke it. Here's a look at it. A little sidearm spinner, and he just got enough of it. Wasn't a no doubt about it, but outfielders were playing shallow, and he got just enough to get it over that wall.
And this next hitter they're going to have to be careful with, too, because Dimitri Anhedia, he unloaded a home run that put them ahead the other day, 1-0 on Mexico. So Anhedia, he's also long ball hitter here.
It's a dangerous team, speed and power.
Remember I said 22-0. And they'd only been behind in 3 innings. Well, now we can make it 4.
Hello.
So California will be trying to do something that they haven't done here. And that's come from behind. Base hit.
That was another little sidearm spinner. You know, throughout the Little League World Series, almost every year I've been here 5 years now, it's the hard, overpowering fastball that gets the batters out. When you start slinging a lot of breaking pitches up there, they make the adjustments.
Now, in Little League Baseball, everybody has to play, and you can use special pinch runners. So entering the game now is Garcia. He will be the special pinch runner there, number 6. Now, the rule change this year is that you must have one at bat. There is the special runner rule. But you also must play for 3 outs. And otherwise, defensively, in any, it used to be or, remember that? That was a year ago. But now they've changed the rules. It makes a little bit of a difference here tonight because Curaçao has a 14-player roster and Thousand Oaks, California, a 12-player roster. So Curaçao has to substitute early and often. Our hitter right now is Courtney Duran, with Curaçao leading California 3-0.
And Brett, that's a great rule because it allows every kid to play. Now here's what the umpire is seeing on this foul tip, and this is going to go right off the catcher's mask. He's looking down at the catcher.
Carp. Second to end the inning, but not before. The champions of the Caribbean score 3 runs, 2 of them on this home run, Harold.
Yurickson Profar, one of the top hitters in the game, gets one off speed, drives it out of the ballpark. Big 3-run lead. Let's see if the U.S. can get to the big fella.
Great scene at the Little League Field of Dreams here in central Pennsylvania. And program reminder that tomorrow night here on ABC, Pride on the line. Eddie George leads the Cowboys against former teammate Steve McNair and the Titans. Don't miss this Monday Night Football preseason special, 8 Eastern on ABC Sports Championship Television. Story of two quarterbacks. Steve McNair at the age of 31. He is just entering his athletic peak, the AFC Player of the Year a year ago. And Testaverde, many Testaverde, trying to find new life with his old coach, Bill Parcells, down in Dallas. He'll be 41 in November. And you just gotta wish Vinny an awful lot of luck down there. And of course, the Cowboys are counting on him to generate some offense. And won't it be fun to watch Eddie George carrying against that former team of his? Al and John will have all the action for you tomorrow. We're approaching football, college football, full swing next week. You folks in Southern California got to enjoy the Trojans, but a little bit closer than you might have expected against Virginia Tech, huh? And four defensive replacements go in. But that, I was just looking, the entire outfield has been changed. Now, that, of course, is in keeping with that rule that you must play one complete inning defensively, and you also must bat. So we've got brand new outfield here for Curacao, and they have a 3-0 lead. Top of the second. Here's the catcher, John Lister, swinging for the diamond on that one, wasn't he, Harold?
He's letting it go, no doubt about it. But they got to be a little more aggressive. They were pretty passive, and I understand that Pineda was off a little bit and was wild, but the passiveness, I think, hurt these youngsters in the first inning.
Out the corner. You know, a three-run lead, it does wonders for so many pitchers, as you see the comparison between Lister and Pineda. Pineda, one of the leading sluggers, as is Lister. Both have hit 3 home runs here.
He was pitching the game the other day against the kids from Asia, from Chinese Taipei, and he had a 2-run lead. He said, "The game is over." And they came back and got him. The confidence was good.
Come on, three strikes.
Yeah, it's amazing what 3 runs could do to a 12-year-old. I mean, the first thing, it was all balls, and now it's all strikes, and that one was plenty close.
And it's tough to be an umpire in this league because the catchers are going to hold it on you, and they're going to pull it back and make it look even worse.
They pull it from the dugout, and they'll frame it there forever. You know? Now, a major league umpire would say, "Come on, come on, come on. Don't be showing me up." Got him that time. Took a strike three. That is the third strikeout by Pineda. He has struck out 3 of the last 4 hitters.
Well, he's abandoned all the junk, and he said, "Here's the fastball, hit it." You see the 4-seam fastball. That's when you see that rotation of the seams. And then here's a good look from what the umpire sees.
Now, here is their ace pitcher, and he showed it yesterday in shutting out Texas on a one-hitter. This is Cody Thompson taking the ball up high. Unfamiliar territory for the youngsters from California, trying to come from behind and trailing by 3 runs. Little league team that is 22-0 since mid-June. And Pineda now is just rocketing him past it.
1-1
You know, one of the things that California talked about was the adjustments. They saw great pitching all the way through, Brent. And they said, "Today we're going to back up in the box. You see how far back in the box he is to give yourself a little bit more of an opportunity to catch up that fastball." Now, it's not working yet, but they're trying something to do a little different.
Get there. Running the team from that third base coach's box, and there's a view of what Harold was telling you. And he now has struck out 4 of the last 5 hitters.
He's feeling the confidence too. He's letting it go. Here's a good look again what the umpire sees. Great fundamentals and just busting the ball inside, unable to catch up to it. Right now, he's in such a good groove and he's overpowering the middle part of this order.
It is amazing, isn't it, folks, what 3 runs can do for you when you're 12 years old? Let me just rocket back. Changed on him that time. Oh, my. The James Brady, the starting second baseman, the hitter. He is a Pac-Man, isn't he? 107 pounds of dynamite.
Now, Brent, we've talked about how far back. How far back in the box can you go?
1-1
Watch strike. Where James Brady puts his foot. As far back as you can possibly get. Now, this gives him another 3 feet almost to see the ball. So instead of 46 feet, now he's getting that ball from 49 feet. And then they saw him way back there and said, okay, well then let's see if we can wait that long. That's what that little change up would do to you. Ephus curveball. A little cat and mouse from both the coaching staffs.
Over there on the other side, Michelangelo, he calls the pitches for Curacao. And he strikes out the side. Four strikeouts in a row. Five of the last six hitters.
It's been the fastball. I mean, he just reached back and has been coming right after him. Like you said, five out of the six hitters. Mr. Pineda, 70 miles an hour, 71, and he's just bringing it. After this, a commercial from our ABC stations.
Now, no one has more fun at the Little League World Series than the mascot, Dugout, leading a little pregame dance with the Islanders down there before we got underway. Right now, Curacao leads California 3-0, and they're coming up here in the bottom of the second. Jordan Brower back on the mound for the Californians, but the team did tell Tyler Karp, the shortstop, to loosen up just a little bit in case they have to make a change. He would be the next pitcher in. Liberia due to lead it off here for Curacao. Curacao up 3-0. Profar smacking a two-run homer. Shortstop Jonathan Scope driving in the other run. And we are in the bottom of the second inning.
Ball.
Attendance tonight, 34,550. And that hillside gets packed early. You know we got a good crowd.
Ball.
Sure do. The shots from the blimp that we had earlier just showed how big the crowd was. It's amazing. This complex continues to grow.
Yeah, there's another great field just adjacent to this one. And when they expanded to 16 teams, they built a second classic Little League stadium. And you can see out on the hillside, out beyond the left field fence, these folks come real early. And Brower got a called strike on that low pitch again. And now you see Volunteer Stadium just toward the top of your screen up there. They played the consolation game over there earlier today. Richmond, Texas, a winner over Mexico.
Ball four.
Ball four. So Brower continuing to struggle here. And his replacement would be shortstop Tyler Karp.
It's almost like the run and shoot offense. You know, we were talking about that earlier in the week. They put so much pressure on you, and they continue to just run till you tag them.
Here's Ronde showing bunt. He is the catcher and the ninth hitter here for Curacao. One of the things I notice about this three-run Curacao explosion, it has sort of taken the crowd out of this game. Do you notice how quiet it is? The United States fans kind of sitting back a little bit and in on the hands and out of self-preservation, he fouled that one.
You're not kidding.
And they take a look at the fans from Thousand Oaks. They just haven't had anything to get excited about over here. Up high, and Brower missing again, and he's really struggling trying to find the strike zone. Meanwhile, you can just imagine what's going on down on the island of Curacao. In fact, we were told that the other day they called off a government meeting so they could watch Little League Baseball.
It's
everybody excited about this team.
Well, and it's amazing how much the Little League World Series has grown. Little League Baseball, it's just captured the minds of people. Everybody watches it and shut down a country like you're talking about.
Ronde lays it down. Leon slips. And Ronde zips to first.
He had an idea in his mind. He was going to barehand that ball and throw it to second base. Now, we saw the great double play he turned last night. Now, it's, again, it's very slick, and they use rubber spikes in Little League Baseball. And when the humidity and the dew is on the ground, it's tough to keep the traction. You know, the one thing that stands out of my mind is getting out. And that's something you'll learn later on as baseball goes on, as you see a first pitch foul back on a bunt. They're going to keep putting it on you.
Now, this is Garria, Christopher Garria, who entered as an outfield substitute. So this will be his at-bat here in the second inning. Riondell Walter had been the leadoff hitter. He's out for this at-bat and fouls that bunt off. So they're trying to put him in motion right now. And we've noticed that Curacao can do that with great speed.
And it's a scripted game they play. It was interesting in the meeting. They said, here's the moves we're making. Here's where we'll make them. That's what we do every game.
Nothing changes.
Ball!
High and tight. And now I believe that Tom has asked Karp from the dugout if he's ready. We'll see what happens here, but Tom was talking to Karp. Pops it up.
Infield fly.
Makes the put out. Now, how come big league pitchers don't come in and catch those pop-ups like
first
that?
First thing I thought about. I don't know. It's so funny because Major League, if you go to Major League batting practice, the guys running around shagging fly balls are all the pitchers making all the great catches.
Is this leadoff hitter?
This is Ignacio. Another pinch hitter coming up. Drops down a bunt. Brower's got the man at third on the force. Did not hesitate.
And there it is, taking the out. If they're going to give you an out, you take it. And that's how you win Little League Baseball games. A couple things to look at here. As the runner slides into third, what's the third base that's going to blast out of there? That is a safety device that they have in Little League Baseball. And then the fundamental play, just catch it. They knew the situation, first and second, you got to force the third. Very nice play.
And here's Jonathan Scope. Line drive, base hit left field. They'll hold the runner up. Brower cuts it off. Bases are loaded.
Well, you got a chance to see McIntyre's arm. He's one of the top pitchers for this team from California. They weren't going to challenge him this time. He held him up. He held him up immediately. He was starting to get excited. Then he realized he's not going to make it. Now they stay aggressive. You see the slip and the dive back. Now you can dive back into bases, but you cannot dive head first when you're... You can't slide head first, you can dive back.
Now, here's why you stopped him at third. You got your cleanup hitter coming up. Ground ball to third. Effort right there. Pick up by Cronenbold, who retires the side. So California survives a Curacao threat. They still trail it by three, and they will be coming up now. The top of the third. Man, that looks good, doesn't it? Back at the Little League World Series, and let's check in down below with Grant.
Thanks a lot, Brent. I'm here at one of the most favorite snack spots at the Little League World Series. It's our snow cone place. It's cherry. We got blue raspberry, both hot commodities on this warm night. I'm going to go with the cherry. Very good flavors. Brent, it looks good down here.
Hey, Grant, that little cast on your left arm there, young man. Next time at practice in football, wrap up.
That's
wrap
right. Up. I'll protect a little better.
Here we are, Lavity Stadium. A warm, muggy day here in South Williamsport, but the Little League luck is holding here tonight, folks. Thunderstorms raging all around us, but not at the Little League World Series. They are rocking here tonight, and it's 3-0, and those fans from Curacao, they are fired up over there. The island, one of five islands that comprise the Netherlands Antilles, great smiles, Pineda, Scope the shortstop, and why not? The youngsters are up by three, top of the third. Pineda's working on a no-hitter. Life is great.
It's fantastic.
Stepping in now is Cronenbold, and California could use some base runners here. Now to see if he should take this next one. Choking up. Bottom of the order. He'd like to get to the big fellas. You know, one thing I have noted in the last few days, Harold, where we've been doing the finals, you don't get a lot of teams automatically taking a strike when they're down 2-3 runs like you'll see in the major leagues.
Yeah,
and I'm kind of surprised by that.
I'm with you. I'm surprised too. And especially when you have a pitcher on the mound that has a tendency to be all over the place.
Right.
Make him work a little bit.
The Curaçao flag. Inside now, and it goes to 3-1.
See, even this pitch right here, if you've got enough confidence that he's going to put the ball in play,
let him
take 3-1, see what happens. You might get a walk, and then it goes 3-2. You're going to see a fastball anyway.
He's had one finger down. Fouled it away, 3-2.
There you go.
One thing they do know is they know their players. They've been around them a long time and they're on a nice little run. So
three balls, two strikes.
They understand who can put the ball in play and who can't.
Right.
See,
protect,
choking
Taylor,
up
protect.
With two strikes.
Stay back.
Got him on high heat. And he has struck out 5 hitters in a row. And a reminder that this fall, the benefactor is looking for the contestant with millionaire qualities. And the game starts the minute they walk through the door. Who will pass his test for success? The benefactor premieres Monday, September 13th, only on ABC. He has struck out 6 of the last 7 California hitters, 5 of them in a row. Leadoff hitter Ginther up. He's one of 2 base runners California's had here tonight, hit by a pitch on a 3-ball count that was inside back in the first inning. And there's your father-son combinations here on this team as Tom, the manager, looks down at young Tim. A little look of growing concern over here with the way Pineda may have settled in after his team staked him to that 3-run lead.
He's rolling right now. But his pitch count is going up, so if they can get to him in the middle of the innings, he got a little tired against the team from Asia and actually gave up 8 earned runs in that ball game, and in the 6th inning gave up 4 earned runs. So that was the difference, that you got to try to get deep in the game with this young man.
Right at the belt. The first inning, of course, by far the longest, and that 49 pitches now. 27 of the strikes, not a strong ratio. So just like Harold pointed out, as the third baseman Profar comes in just in case Ginther drops it down. And that time Pineda got the call.
Brent, it's kind of funny watching the defense. Every time you see this ball here, I don't know if you give him that one. I know it's Little League, but that's maybe a little bit too wide. No.
Yeah, that was pretty high.
This defense is going to run whatever direction they think he's going to throw. That's the right fielder moving to left.
Struck him out. And the strikeout total swells to 7 on the game. 6 in a row for Pineda. And here's Leon with his father coaching first base.
Another hard fastball just up in the zone. I tell you, a lot of people think a high pitch is easy to hit. If you get a high fastball, that's tough to catch up to when he's throwing as hard as he is.
Sean McIntyre would be next.
This is the one guy I think can turn things around. If he's able to put the bat on the ball, come up with something big, I think it'll turn emotionally everybody all the way around.
Inside, missing again.
One ball, one strike.
Dad, a little nervous. And he's not.
Looking with that high heat right now.
I like what we're seeing. I mean, he's just basically, he's only thrown 2 off-speed pitches I can even remember. Other than that, he's just saying, here's my fastball, catch up to it.
Yeah, there's no question that the fastball is the best pitch in Little League Baseball. You watch these big fellas year in and year out. That one was close.
Catcher Rigi Rondé has got Some nice hands back there, too, bringing that ball back every time. Yeah, nice job. Got his Terminator outfit on back there.
Got the side again for the second consecutive inning. Carlos Pineda strikes out the side. Cronenbohl, Ginther, and Leon down. And now eight strikeouts, seven of them consecutively.
Back here at the Little League World Series, a special evening for three lovely ladies, the 2004 enshrinees of the Hall of Excellence. It'll be Chrissy Wendell, Kathy Gehring, and Nancy Dosfries. Joining me right now, Chrissy Wendell. Now, the thing about you, in 1994, she was the first catcher, the first female catcher to play here in the Little League World Series. My, how times have changed. You had two girls playing here this year. But how did not only the fans but your teammates receive you?
I think by the time we got to the Little League World Series, I think we played like 28 games or something. I think they were pretty used to me being around. I almost was just one of the guys, I think. They were just kind of used to me, and they didn't treat me any different. It was pretty exciting for our team.
Well, congratulations on the honor, Chrissy.
Thank you very much.
Brent Harold.
Thank you, Sam. And we move to the bottom of the third. Curacao 3, California nothing. And Jurickson Profar, who slammed that two-run homer in the first inning, steps in here in the bottom of the third. So a rematch time for young Jordan Brower.
You know, thinking back at Chrissy right there, she was a 2002 silver medalist in ice hockey. And you know what? I guess that catching helped out.
I'd say.
A little hand-eye coordination.
Was she the goalie?
I don't know about that. Just hitting the stick. It's got to help.
Karp to Leon for the putout.
Well, that was a big out because that was the young man who hit the big home run that put him ahead. And I know we were talking about field hockey for a second, but here's a good look. He threw the knuckleball at him and got him out front. That was the first knuckleball we've seen of the night. And that's what you get out of a knuckleball. You get that ground ball. There's another one. So maybe he's decided that, you know what, my sidearm fastball is not working. Let me go to the knuckler.
Haney up. He's singled back in the first inning. Or I should check that now. We've got a pinch hitter up here, Charlton Martis. So the graphic was correct on the hitter. 1-1 with one out.
One ball, one strike.
The second baseman of the right fielder, and it falls in. It was just the right spot. A very tough play for either of those youngsters, although I'm sure you would agree that the right fielder has the call in that situation.
Oh, absolutely. And the communication is the second baseman. You don't say anything until you get there. Obviously, they're both talking. Only one can be heard, so you can see the second baseman speaking. Don't say anything. Try to get underneath it. Let the outfielder call that ball. That's how the communication on a play between the infielders and the outfielders works.
Rafaela, Willie Rafaela, hitting now. So he's got his at bat. He shortens up with one out, the teammate on at first.
One ball, one strike.
The littlest guy in the Little League World Series, 4'7", and his pitcher is 5'11". This little man can swing the bat, though. It'll be cool.
That's fair ball, the signal is. Safe at second base. That ball just fair in front of the plate there. That was close.
It really was. And Lister popped out, made a nice play. The decision was good. Yeah, defense has been the key for this California team. They're not executing it tonight. You see the catcher pop out and comes up to throw a strike, but it's just a little high. And again, another gamble.
Got to just stay focused and stay with, do what you're doing. You know, things will happen. It'll turn around, okay? Help these guys out here with a little bit. If you see a pop-up like that, hey, help them out. If you scream and yell, and let's get some communication going, okay? Take charge out there for us. You're doing a heck of a job. Your confidence level is high right now. You're throwing strikes. That's all I can ask you.
That's good to hear the coach got to bolster his confidence. You know, he's got a couple of Curacao runners on first and second. Quincy Van Blarkum This will be his at bat right now, and these fellas are dropping these bunts down, aren't they?
Yes, they are, and that's what you do at this level. Make them field the ball. I know we talked about how great defense they were, but they're still 11 and 12-year-olds who put the pressure on them. They're going to make mistakes every now and then, and that's what Curacao's capitalized on.
One out. Base runners on at first and second base here.
One ball, one strike.
Base hit, past the right fielder. It eludes Thompson. One run scores. And they've got a runner hung up. Runner trying to score is safe. And two runs score, and the hitter, Van Blarkum, goes all the way to third base. And again, Harold, you put your finger right on it. Man, a team that has just been fabulous defensively has lost its wheels here tonight.
Again, the pressure, and the thing you see with Little League is the decisions that you have to make. And their minds are clicking, but their bodies don't always make the are able to execute the decisions that they're thinking. And that's what you see. That's what distinguishes 11 and 12-year-olds from maybe a little
fine.
Older.
Go to left field.
So it looks like the decision has been made, and the left-hander, Sean McIntyre, has been called in, and we'll come back after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Back in South Williamsport, 5-0 Curacao, shutting out an unbeaten Little League team from Thousand Oaks, California. And Sean McIntyre, a couple games ago, was brilliant as the starting pitcher. Now comes on here, and he will face the number 9 hitter, the catcher, Ronde. Runner on at third, lays down the bunt, picked up by Leon, who makes an alert tag. And he is a fine athlete.
He's out.
He was checking that runner all the way. Watch him. Watch his eyes on this play as he makes the unassisted put out.
You're absolutely right. I mean, he knew the situation. He's already ready to throw the ball anywhere he had to throw it. He looked home, and then he saw the runner going down third because he thought for sure he'd be going home.
That's a big put out. Now two out. Adames is the pinch runner, the designated pinch runner. And our hitter for the second time is Garria. So with two out, two in, and a Curacao runner on at third base, they lead California by 5, and he was going to drop down a two-out bunt. They seem to have found a weapon here, Harold.
Yes, they have, and they've played this style the whole time. And then you have three guys in the lineup with the power that are going to hurt you, and this is the type of game they play.
So McIntyre comes in, faces two hitters, ends the threat, but not before Curacao makes it 5-0. This Little League World Series moment is presented by Berry Burst Cheerios. Defense played here at this Little League World Series. Unfortunately, California doesn't have any highlights tonight to add to that package. I noted this morning in the Williamsport Sun-Gazette, a writer asked 5 members of Curacao who was the best player at the Little League World Series this year. And our pitcher, Carlos Pineda, said, myself, because I'm hitting very well. I mean, the young man's pitching pretty well right now. 7 consecutive strikeouts, 8 overall. He's working on a no-hitter as we come to the top of the 4th inning with the pitcher, Sean McIntyre, going to lead it off. In fact, 4 of the 5 said, me. The 5th one said, you know what the 5th one said? The third baseman for Taiwan, because defensively he's one of the best of the game. All back.
He had a good game, too, Chinchilla. He was picking everything. I'm surprised that they haven't tried to bunt or manufacture any get him off the mound in any sort of way. A lot of times that's what you do when you see a pitcher in good rhythm, bunt, get him out of that.
Your hands are sweaty, get the dirt.
This is the biggest deficit that California has ever faced, being down by 5 runs here in South Williamsport. They were down, and I believe it was their first game against Rhode Island. Out in the regional, a very tough regional, they trailed the Little League team from Henderson, Nevada, which is, of course, a suburb right there of Las Vegas, and a very good Little League team. They were down a couple runs to them, but now they face a 5-0 deficit. Middle of the batting order up here. And Max starts it off on a base hit. The first base hit of Carlos Pineda.
And I think that's the first time we've heard this crowd in about 3 innings, too. So here's a nice swing. He just takes this ball inside out, right back up the middle. Beautiful.
Now it's Jordan Brower, who moved on out to left field. And the California youngsters will see if they can mount something here. Flying right back in the thick of it. Be followed by Tyler Karp and then John Lister. So this is the very heart of this lineup here from Thousand Oaks.
Now we were talking earlier, he gave up, he being Pineda, but gave up 4 runs in one inning against a team from Asia to put him back in that ball game. So he can get to once he's gotten tired. He's getting a little tired now.
But he's moved ahead in this count. Ball and 2 strikes.
You're on TV, Michelle.
I was talking to someone who I'm sure is watching it. Ball and 2 strikes. And got him for the first out of the inning, strikeout number 9.
Well, he's been struggling a little bit today, and I know he feels bad, but his defense really let him down. Right here, it's just a fastball that gets by him. That's one of those things, but, you know, this is one of those character-building deals, and he'll realize that, hey, he didn't give up all those runs. Those balls fell in, and his defense let him down a little bit today when he's on the mound.
Yeah, the one thing we notice about teams that struggle in a game, they're depressed for about 15, 20 minutes.
Yeah.
The Texas youngsters, they shook it off, came back here today with a win.
Hello.
A lot of the joke is that they say who's got the best ice cream after the game, but it's really true. I mean, 5-10 minutes when they're out of here, they're back up there in the Grove, and they're celebrating, they're trading pins, and they're doing all kinds of different things. All the kids hang out in one area called the Grove. It's like a dormitory just for kids only. All 16 teams stay up in there.
And Pineda coming right back here. Well, after all, they are the United States champions.
Absolutely. And a lot of times that's what the U.S. teams come here to play for. That's where all the youngsters stay, and only people allowed to, they're assigned an adult supervisor plus their coaches. That's it. Parents aren't allowed anybody. It's all about the kids. They have more than 3 square meals a day. They eat whatever they want all day long. Video games, ping pong, the top accommodations that you can imagine.
So 2-2 and one out here with a base runner on. Sean McIntyre at first base. Trying to cut into this 5-run deficit. And Tyler battles away.
And you're seeing one thing starting to happen. They're making contact with 2 strikes. We didn't see that through the first 3 innings. And now, 2 strikes before was an automatic, strikeout. He had how many strikeouts early? 8, 9?
He has a total of 8, and he had 7 of them rung up in a row.
Yeah. So they weren't making contact.
Made contact there with 2 out. Got him. I think the ump changed his mind. Hesitated just a moment. And then he called McIntyre out on the force. It was close.
Here's a view from his hat. This is what he was looking at, as you see the pivot from the second baseman. There's no doubt he's out. And he got the right call. Look at Jonathan Scope pulled the ball right at him. You see, I picked it. It's clean.
Now Lister steps in with two out.
Yes, he did.
Around.
That looked like a swing where he was told the ball was going to be on the outside and it busted him in. A lot of times they try to tip the hitter off. It doesn't always work that way at this level. It doesn't mean the pitcher's going to hit a spot.
Come on.
You know, he dug himself a hole with that bunt. Foul.
Hitter. Not a.
Lamadee Stadium in South Williamsport. On a warm, muggy Sunday with Curacao playing for the championship. The first time in its Little League history. Leading Thousand Oaks, California by 5 runs. And he's hit his second batter of the evening, putting 2 runners on. And
the ball is going to graze right off his elbow. And Lister's a tough kid, Brent. Barely even flinched on this thing. It almost looks like he stuck his elbow out there.
That football play, linebacker, running back. And stepping in now is Cody Thompson. And the one thing that the California team has to be mindful of now, they have 3 fellows over there in the dugout who have not appeared. I don't believe he's substituted yet, has he?
No, he has not. I agree with you.
At the inside corner, I think he was considering a pinch hitter, but in this situation, he wanted to give Cody Thompson a chance to rocket one out of here and get him right back in the game. Because he held Cody up momentarily over there. But if you don't get your players in, you should have to win the game. Of course, you're going to lose by a forfeit. So we're here in the top of the fourth with 2 out.
Ball.
Just to keep him awake out.
Yeah. Just having fun playing a little catch.
Sure. Ronde said, let me just rifle that one down. Ball and 2 strikes. Cody Thompson. 2 California runners on. They trail it by 5. High in the air. Foul territory. First baseman slips. Stays with it for the putout. Correa makes the final out of the inning. And California still scoreless. And now they are through 4. Curacao closing in on his first championship ever. They lead it by 5. This is the World Series of pen trading. And I mean, everybody's looking for one for Harold Reynolds. They wait for him outside, folks.
I got this one up in the tent. They're turning my shirt inside out.
Anybody got a Mexico pen?
That goes on all week long here at South Williamsport. It's 5-0 Curacao with the lead. And we look ahead to Thursday night, September 9th. ABC Monday Night Football opens its 35th anniversary season. The Super Bowl champion Patriots take on the Indianapolis Colts. Plus, NFL opening kickoff celebrates the new season with a special featuring Elton John, Lenny Kravitz, Jessica Simpson, and Toby Keith. All happens Thursday night, September 9th at 8 Eastern on ABC Sports Championship Television. Elton John's making quite a stir out there in Vegas.
Is that right?
Yeah, he's got a red piano.
Oh, he does.
Here's the defensive replacement, sir.
Here's the changing again. If you're just joining us, every little leaguer has to play at least 3 outs and have 1 at-bat. So, or you lose the game by forfeit. This is the 4th inning, and looks like the rain's going to hold off, Brent, because we had a lot of threat for rain. And looks like we're going to get this ball game in, which is good news for everybody.
5-0 lead here for Curacao. Ignacio, second at bat.
I like the game the kids from Curacao have played. They played the way they played all week long. Caught the ball, put pressure on you, and the big guys hit the home runs. That's what they've done all week.
Nice breaking ball from McIntyre. That's his second strikeout. Now shortstop Jonathan Scope. 2 for 2 tonight and scored one of the 5 runs back in the first inning. Came around when Profar hammered a 221-foot home run over the center field fence. So it's McIntyre against Scope. I think last night when we were looking ahead to this game, you and I assumed that John McIntyre would get the ball and be on the mound.
Yeah, he was the guy that they went to in the semifinal game. Pitched a fantastic game for them, and you thought for sure he pitched Wednesday, just like Pineda pitched on Wednesday for the team from Curacao. I thought he'd be ready, and now he's logging some innings anyway.
Deep to right field. Back. Reaches up and makes the grab. Cody Thompson.
You just don't see that at this level. He knew exactly where he's at. You saw him reach back for the fence. He took a home run from Jonathan Scope, the hero from last night's game on the mound, and now he's out in right field. That's a heck of a catch, Brent.
We can add that to that defensive highlight reel that we saw earlier in the broadcast. Carlos Pineda, the pitcher, who's working on a one-hitter right now. Can't believe it.
They'll probably greet him on the way in, give him a handshake. You see a lot of that here in the World Series. Saw one pitcher from Rhode Island just dominating, throwing a no-hitter through about 5 innings. He gives up a home run to Justin Black from Iowa, and he gave him a high five going around third base.
Well, you make great friends here. Pineda becomes the third strikeout victim for Sean McIntyre. McIntyre looks strong, but can California break through? They're down by 5. We've got 2 more at-bats, and we're back after this message and a word from our ABC stations.
Come on!
The Little League World Series World Championship on ABC Sports, brought to you by Honda, proud to be the official vehicle of Little League Baseball, and McDonald's.
That's the dugout umpire square dance. Todd Tolino from Ashtabula, Ohio. And, you know, Harold, it's worth taking a look at Thompson's fine play in right field again.
Well, watch him get back on this ball. Knows exactly where he's at. And I love the reaction of Timmy Ginther, the center fielder. What a great play. And you know, that's what it's all about right there. That's what he's going to remember. Not the fact he struck out last inning. He'll remember the great catch.
Top of the fifth inning here. Crowd of 34,000 plus on hand for the Little League Championship game. Total attendance 327,526. As you look down on our scene, aerial coverage courtesy of the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company and its fleet of airships, reminding you to travel with peace of mind on Goodyear's new Assurance tires. Our pilot, Marty Chandler, and I'll tell you, folks, when you see the blimp up there, that's good news from a weather standpoint. That's chances are we're going to clear, and there's no thunderstorm closing in on South Williamsport. Those fellows, they checked that radar carefully, and it took a while for the blimp to get up here tonight. Did you notice?
Yes, I did.
But man, what a big smile across Harold Leno's face when he saw the first picture coming from above. Skies are clear. Evan Urchella now went in to play center field. Chokes up on that bat. Just trying to give California a base runner here, trying to get started in the fifth inning. Remember, now Little League Baseball scheduled 6 innings. California trailing it by 5. Only the fourth time that they've been behind all summer long, and only the second time in this competition. Rhode Island having scored first on them in their opening game. Now 2-0.
Evan's a little spark plug. He'll take a pitch here and and he'll try to manufacture anyway. He got him a big hit last night. This is the little league walk you use to take.
That's
right. There, wave the bat a little bit.
You gotta love him.
And he'll put the ball in play. Nice base hit up the middle last night.
Rips that one away. Pineda has struck out 9. He surrendered only that single to Sean McIntyre in the last inning. Struggled in the first inning, and since then, has he ever settled down? And you can see that size. That's intimidating to a 12-year-old when he steps down at you. You can imagine Randy Johnson coming off the mound. The fellas in the big leagues know exactly what I'm talking about with that stride of his. And you see Pineda step down and come in firing like this. You just haven't got much reaction time. And that is the 10th strikeout of the night.
And he's starting to smell it, too. Starting to feel this victory coming on.
Derek Francis, left-handed hitter.
You know, it comes a little league, you see a big kid like that on the mound, the first thing everybody starts thinking about, is he eligible? They check so hard now after the whole Danny Almonte thing, way back before they even sign up. They don't wait till they qualify for Little League World Series, they get it done right away.
Of course, a few years ago, Danny Almonte was a couple of years too old, and so that team from the Bronx was disqualified. Flashes one away, and you know, I really happy to report that he's having a successful high school career. And like Little League officials, I never thought that you should blame the youngster. The coach of that team and the parent, of course, have been suspended, a lifetime ban from Little League baseball. But I think a lot of people are pulling for Danny Almonte. The one thing he's going to have to get beyond, I think I read a story in the New York Times on him, and the coach of his high school team said, you know, it's tough for him because everybody asks that question first, and they will continue to ask it. Another scout I talked to, Harold, told me that he could wind up playing outfield. He's a pretty good hitter. And there's strikeout number 11.
Well, he's got great tools, and they won a state championship this year in New York, a city championship for him. So Danny's got a bright future, no doubt.
Yeah, I wish him well. And, you know, it was a bad moment. It was handled properly. And in that year, by the way, looking at this Curacao team, that started their run of 4 consecutive appearances in the international championship. They were beaten by Asia that year. They went into the consolation game. And I remember coming out here watching Almonte, who could not have pitched in the United States championship, but he came back in that consolation game. He beat Curacao. And then, of course, they were stripped of that 3rd place, and Curacao was awarded the spot. And a nice play there by Van Blarkum at 2nd base. And California down to its last 3 outs. Being shut out here by Curacao, 5-0. And right now around the world, there are 7,000 teams getting ready for next year. Live that dream. 16 of them get to come here to South Williamsport. This is the young man from Chinese Taipei, and the reason why he was selected to throw out the first pitch is he was suffering from chicken pox, and so he was unable to play. And doctors, of course, cleared him, and out he came, and that's the only ball he has thrown here in South Williamsport. That was a great honor. If you go back to Chinese Taipei, and they were disqualified from Little League competition, not because they were using youngsters who were too old, but because the leagues they were choosing from too large a pool of youngsters. They chose from the pool that included their school district, and they wouldn't change until this year. And finally, when they did change and they went to a smaller talent pool, Little League Baseball left them back in, and they came out of Asia. I don't know if they played Korea and Japan themselves, but Japan had been here, and Japan had eliminated Curacao for the World Series final for 3 years in a row. As Jonathan Scope, the shortstop, getting loose out there, out beyond the right field fence, just in case he's needed here in the final inning. Jonathan shutting it up there with the crowd pretty good. Here's Yerickson Profar, hammered a 200-foot home run back in the first inning. When you go back, it was a huge blow in this game. There were two out, one in, and he suddenly made it a 3-0 game. If you want to pick out one blow in this game, and it grew so quiet over there on the California side. In front of the center fielder for a base hit, and his second hit of the game. But he really launched this one back in the first inning, 221 feet.
And I think the key is what you said, there was two outs. That broke the game wide open, and it took the crowd totally out of the game. You know, we've been here where they start chanting USA, USA, and it intimidates the other kids from the other bracket, the international bracket, but that has not happened today. It took them right out of the game.
Charlton Martiz. Here's our batter. It's his second at bat. Chance for a double play. Got it. Nicely turned by Brady, who returned to second base in this half inning. Tagged the runner out coming down, then through to first. Now, Harold, for Little Leaguers, what should the base runner have done in that situation when he saw what the second baseman was going to do?
Well, there's only two things to do. You've got to stop and try to make him have to chase you. That allows the runner going down the line to be safe, force the second baseman to make a decision. But that was really a difficult one because it was bang, bang. The ball was there when he got there. What I liked from James on that play was that he may or may not have touched the base runner, and he continued on his throw anyway, as if he already did. You know, just went ahead and played it through.
Rafaela takes a strike with two out. So Sean McIntyre has come on here in relief, and he's done a dandy job. He hasn't given up a run. Nobody on with two out, bottom of the fifth inning. And that is strikeout number four for McIntyre since coming on in the third inning. California down to its last at bat. They need a big rally against Curaçao. Well, who's the best golfer in the world? Is it Tiger Woods or Vijay Singh? Don't miss what could be a historic showdown at the Deutsche Bank Championship. Coverage begins Sunday at 5 Eastern and then continues next Monday, Labor Day, at 3 Eastern on ABC Sports Championship Television. What a year Vijay Singh is putting together right now. As you take a look at our summary of this World Championship between Thousand Oaks, California, and Curaçao, Netherlands Antilles. Antilles, of course, is what that stands for in the H-O, the old abbreviation for Holland. And if you missed it at the top of the broadcast, athletes from Curaçao eligible to play on Holland's Olympic teams, and 7 graduates of their Little League Baseball program played in the Olympics in Greece for Holland. And the young man who has dominated this game here tonight is Carlos Pineda. And as we come to the bottom half of the hour, if you're just clicking in to check, is this the World Championship game of Little League Baseball? 7,000 teams down to this. This, the last inning. Great stab at third, throw over. Got it. Good play at both ends. Profar and then Gurria making the stretch at first base. And there's one out.
He was playing so close in. That's why he's able to make this throw across the diamond on his knees. Terrific play, but the play was made by the first baseman, Brent. Watch him lay out. I think he's on the base. That's a good call. Get a better look at it. When he catches that ball, he's all over the base. That's an excellent call and a terrific play.
That is Gurria, who was a substitute at first base. It was close, wasn't it, folks? It was close. Danny Leon, one out now, and Curaçao.
I want an answer. You had a direct line to that
site.
We got
it. We got now. Let's get back in the box. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. We'll play ball. No. The call stands. Let's play.
Now, Tom is, I think, asking the plate umpire to overrule on this, that the first baseman was off the bag. Saying that he had a better view as he looked down the line.
They still got Danny Leon. Now here's the catch. Once you make the catch, he's made the catch clean. Now his momentum's going to carry him off. it's a close play, but he made the right. I think it's the right call, Brent.
You thought there was contact with the foot when you saw it. Now Leon,
he stayed at first base because they wanted an appeal.
Okay, that's what. Run out.
And he confirms it with Steve Sambucci out of Englewood, Florida, that he was out.
And that's what Ginther was saying. I want to hear the first base umpire with an appeal. That's what he wanted to check and see, and they did. Here we are.
Sean McIntyre lines one off the right fielder's glove into the wall. McIntyre pulls into second base, and now how big is that play at first?
It's a big play, and McIntyre not fooled at all by Pineda. He gets a fastball, rifles it past the center fielder. So we've got one out, runner second base.
And now Adam Giustiniano. He would be the last hitter who hasn't been used by California. So they come down to the sixth inning, and they have to get the young man in the game or they would forfeit it anyway. And it's strike one with one out and a teammate on at second base with a double. So that's only the second base hit. And off Pineda. And now Giustiniano waits at the plate. Check swing foul. There's the young man at shortstop who warmed up a little bit. But right now, Pineda. Deep. Gone. A two-run homer for California. A pinch-hit home run by Adam Giustiniano. The 12th California player to hit here tonight.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. He took a good swing on that first swing, Brent. And then he got a high fastball and hammered it. Now, you know Pineda's going to be aggressive and just go after him with the fastballs. I think that's going to be it for him. But let's look at just this swing by Giustiniano again. Nice stroke, a fastball. It was a no doubt about it. He hasn't hit that many, so he wasn't sure. And now what's the jubilation? That ball was smoked off the back gate.
And the crowd from California loving it. On the board and still in the thick of it. And is there a greater moment than that for Giustiniano? You're the 12th player to bat and you get it done. Can California keep it going? We'll be back to find out after this message and a word for ABC stations. Twelve-year-old Adam Giustiniano, his favorite baseball player, Vladimir Guerrero, and he made like Vladimir. The California dugout pours out. Now, we go back to that moment of controversy, the play at first base. We're going to rock it back and forth, and we'll show you that I think Harold was absolutely right. Now, look, the ball's in the first baseman's glove. Now, watch that foot down low as we rock the ball in and out of the first baseman's mitt. Arrow looks to me like he's got contact there with the right foot.
Yeah, he's all over the base, and all you got to do is catch it and come off, and it's a force play, so he's out.
One out, two in now, and Tyler Karp hits one down the line. Foul ball. Oh, that was close. Oh, he was nibbling at the chalk, wasn't he, Arrow?
Really was, and it's interesting the system of the umpires. Now, the right field umpire called that the first base ump was looking at the base runner. And this is how close it was.
Just inches.
Wow.
The outfield covered well. Foul back with Scope, the shortstop, now in pitching against Tyler Karp. No balls and two strikes on him. That was Giustiniano's first hit of the Little League World Series. How about that? On the sixth inning, your team down five. And there's There's one of those priceless moments, huh? Line drive right to the shortstop Profar, who would move from third to short. The pitching change, and now Curaçao one out away from their first Little League World Championship. Lead California 5-2, and it won't be easy as John Lister moves into that batter's box. Hit by a pitch in his last at bat. Struck out by Pineda.
This shows you how dominating Pineda was early in the game. Nobody was able to even put the ball in play. Now they're putting it in play. Is it going to be a little bit too late? We'll see.
Scope fires. And he's got Lister in a hole. Curaçao one strike away. Watch the catcher. He'll point this out earlier. Look at the ocean. He framed it. It's outside, but not a crowd. They don't know that. Ground ball. Profar's up with it. And he's safe. Lister keeps California's hopes alive.
Well, that was an interesting, another tough play down there. Let's see. As you see Profar come across, this is going to be a great angle to see. They're saying he pulled the first baseman off. Let's look and see. I don't know if he's off on that one either.
Well, he might be smothering the ball here, though. Well, no, he looked like he made the grab.
Yeah.
He's pretty elastic over there. Thank you very much. And Cody Thompson, who made that fine play in right field. Remember, he took a home run away from Curaçao a little bit earlier here. You down to its last out. League baseball scheduled 6 innings. They trail it by 3. Base runner on. And again now, Curaçao strike away. Maybe you'll be looking to pull the trigger here with 2 strikes. Loop hit, right field, base hit. And Lister dashes to third base. And the tying run here in the sixth will come to the plate for Thousand Oaks, California.
Wow. Impressive play as he scooped it and came up with the throw across the diamond. Watch this. He scoops it, gets up, and throws a bullet to right to third base. It's getting interesting now, Brent.
James Brady will be the hitter.
And that's a good timeout right there. Go out, settle everybody down. You know that youngsters are anxious. They thought they had this game. Now a little more pressure on them. Just settle down, focus.
James Brady, and he's got those lucky wristbands on right now. Digging in with 2 out here in the 6th inning. 5-2, Curaçao leading California. Twice Curaçao has been within 1 strike, and both times California stayed alive. Foul ball. John Lister dashing into third base. He's the catcher. Cody Thompson, base hit over at first base.
One ball, one strike.
And here's Brady, 1-1. And this is quite a moment for Brady because I'm reminded that he came late to the Little League World Series. He was suffering from a struck throat a little bit earlier.
In the dugout.
Two Two balls and one strike. Leon apparently had his foot out just outside the dugout. And, the umpire asking him to step back inside. But two balls and a strike. California crowd coming alive. Ground ball. Let the party begin in Curacao. Gurria stays with it at first base. And what a game he had over there. Curacao's first ever Little League World Championship. Four straight years they've made it to the international finals, eliminated three times in a row by the teams from Japan. But here tonight, against an outstanding team from California, they prevail 5-2.
They played their game, Brent. It was an outstanding game for the kids from Curacao. Pitching and defense, and they came up with a big home run.
A deserving champion, aren't they, Harold?
Yes, they are. That, you know, to this baseball program's come a long ways, and they play the same style every group that comes here. They're going to put pressure on you. They're going to catch the ball, and they'll see what happens.
That flagger, Curacao down here, the fathers, friends, family. And we'll come back to hear from both of these outstanding Little League teams here at South Williamsport in a moment. A very happy group of fans and players from Curacao, their first ever world championship. We go down to Sam Rye with the happy winners.
And Brent, our interpreter Andy Nicholas is joining me here to help me out with this one. We're also joined by Vernon Isabella, the winning manager, and Carlos Pineda, the winning pitcher of this one. I want to ask Vernon if you can help me out here. 4 years here for Curacao, what does this mean for your country?
4 anos que não quero nem ficar para nós.
Uma experiência grande e nós sabemos 4 anos, aí agora para nós que tudo bem, que tudo louco só.
It's a big experience, and it's this time that Curacao won the championship after 4 years.
And a dominant performance by Carlos Pineda on the mound, 11 strikeouts. What did you think of him tonight?
Um rol dominante de Carlos, just um ponte aqui para pensar dia e noite.
Yeah, mas pensou que ia assina, ia tirando, ia completo, já. Eu não tirei completo o menino para papio com ele, então o Jonathan se trabalhou. Quando nós turta, ajuda o outro.
He thought that he was going to pitch the whole game, and he knew that Carlos had good stuff tonight. But even that, he pitched 5 innings, and he knew that Jonathan would come in with a relief pitch and finish the game.
But let's bring in Carlos here now. Come on in here, Carlos. He's talking about your dominant performance here. What was working for you? What pitches were working for you on the mound?
É muito bom viajar tocando o rol dominante hoje. Que lançamento tá bom para a
fastball.
We all understood that one. Now, Carlos, you go back to school this week after several weeks here in Williamsport, Pennsylvania. What's the first thing you tell them?
Eu estou indo à escola, vamos ver a pessoa. Quita por uma coisa, por outra não.
Eu queria fazer 200. Eu sou um treino de baseball para 100 dias, igual de bom.
Tell them they had a very nice and good experience here that motivates more youngsters to get into baseball.
Well, congratulations to the team from Curacao. Enjoy this one. Now let's turn it over to Grant Paulson.
I'm over here with manager Tom Ginther. What a run it was. 22 straight wins to get here. Nothing to hang the hangs down about.
No, as you can tell, the kids are running around and having a blast out here right now. You know what? It's a disappointment, but we're as happy as can be. We're going to come back winners all the way to the West Coast, and I thank our support from our loyal fans out there in Thousand Oaks Canal Valley. You guys are tremendous. We know we had a lot of you guys watching us, and our kids are looking forward to coming home. This has been a long, hard run for them, guys.
What, as a coach and as a team, can you take away from a brilliant experience like this?
Oh, man, this is just, you know, this is going to be unforgettable. 22-0 here until tonight. You know, we came out flat. We had some kids that were sick. You know, we went through 4 cases of strep throat here in the last 2 weeks. You know, hey, we came out and we were dead tired. I mean, if I go back and look at this game, it's going to show. And those, you know, those 3 errors kind of put us down a little bit. But, hey, we battled till the end. You know, we're happy with our effort.
Still muster up the heart to mount a comeback. Controversial call over at first. It looks like it wasn't out there, but pretty close.
Yeah, you know, all I was looking for was an answer from the umpire behind the plate, and he wouldn't give it to me. You know, you go back on that replay, hey, if he's out, he's out. If he's safe, he's safe. I was just looking for an answer from that guy. And, of course, it wasn't given to me. But you know what? Hey, we go on. We scored two runs right after that. We kept battling.
Well, your number one goal was to win the U.S. championship. That you did. Thousand Oaks, the U.S. champions. Nothing to be upset about, Brent.
All right, Grant, good job down there. And class performance by Tom Guenther and this entire team. No shame in losing to this bunch from Curaçao. They were outstanding. Located about 50 miles off the coast of Venezuela, one of the five islands that forms the Netherlands Antilles. Some of you know about one of the others, Bonaire, a great diving site down there in Curaçao. Now a country that just adores baseball, celebrates its first ever Little League World Series championship. And Profar, who pitched brilliantly in the international final, drove a two-run shot in the first inning, and California was digging uphill ever since as he drove in what turned out to be the winning run. California battled back with a couple in the sixth inning, but then Gurria, who played very well as a substitute at first base, dashed over the bag to end the game and send the title down to the Caribbean. Well, once again, this has been a great delight in covering the Little League World Series. And Harold, I want to ask you, looking back in the whole montage, what do you take away from the entire competition, not just tonight's game?
That 327,000 people came to the ballparks and watched them play, and it was a great brand of baseball all the whole series. And we saw over 30 games. The kids played fantastic, and the competition level has really got better through the years. It's amazing what the kids can do at 11 and 12 years old.
And it's amazing across the globe. You know, we had a team from Poland make it into the competition, and every year there's a few girls who come and play for different countries, and even here in the United States. So it is just wonderful as the winner's flag will be taken back to Curaçao, and the youngsters from Thousand Oaks, 22 consecutive wins, and they were behind only three times until tonight's game. And here are the two teams in that wonderful moment here at the Little League Championship when both teams take that victory lap together. We'd like to thank the Goodyear Blimp for that great aerial coverage that they provided all week long here from South Williamsport. Now, final score again, 5-2. Curaçao, 5 runs on 6 hits. Thousand Oaks, 2 runs on 4 hits. And a reminder, tomorrow night, our NFL preseason special, the Titans and the Cowboys at 8 Eastern. And thanks goes out to a hard-working crew. Folks, they did it day in, night out. What a job by this crew. Good night.
Continuing the tradition of excellence, the thrill of victory, and the agony of defeat. This has been a presentation of ABC Sports.